Hey y'all, this is Dr. Carmen Corder with thedoctornurse.com, and in this video we are going to talk about pneumonia. Now before I get started, I want to urge you to head over to thedoctornurse.com, take a peek at the pneumonia pathopedia sneak peek that I have up on the website already. That is just a sneak peek of what you're going to see when the full pathopedia ebook comes out with all the disease processes that I'm covering. I'm real excited about that. Looking forward to getting that out to you guys real soon. But let's just jump right in and start talking about pneumonia. Now, by definition, what is pneumonia? We know that pneumonia involves the alveoli, all right? So it is an infection of the lower airway. The alveoli are where the buck stops with the respiratory system, right? That's where gas exchange takes place. They are the very end of the respiratory system. And so we know with pneumonia, there is an infectious process that causes inflammation within the alveoli. An inflammatory process always causes fluid leakage and fluid buildup. So eventually those alveoli fill up with fluid, and that's where you get your signs and symptoms of pneumonia. Now let's talk about just a few of the risk factors for pneumonia. So a decreased level of consciousness. Well, what does that have to do with pneumonia? Well, people with decreased LOCs are at risk for aspiration, right? So aspiration pneumonia. They're also not as able to cough up and clear secretions. We know that that is a huge contributing factor to pneumonia. Intubation with mechanical ventilation. Now, anybody who is on a ventilator is not able to protect their own airway. They're not able to cough up secretions on their own. So they're kind of relying on the nurse to come in and suction as needed, keep that airway clean and free of excess secretions, perform oral care. As a matter of fact, this is a huge topic kind of going on in evidence-based nursing, where many hospitals have implemented what they call the ventilator bundle. And these are just protocols for the nurse to follow to help prevent our ventilator patients from getting ventilator-associated pneumonia. And those are things like keeping the head of the bed raised up, performing oral care every 2 hours, suctioning as needed, GI prophylaxis, DVT prophylaxis, turning every 2 hours. So that's the ventilator bundle to help prevent ventilator-associated pneumonia. Also being elderly. Elderly people just have decreased immune responses to begin with, so they're going to be at more risk for developing pneumonia as a secondary infection. Let's say, you know, someone 75 years old and they're diabetic, they've got a history of heart disease or whatever, they contract a sinus infection. Well, they're going to be at a much higher risk for that sinus infection than developing into pneumonia than your healthy 20-year-old who catches a sinus infection or develops a sinus infection. Smoking. We know that smoking decreases the action of the cilia within your respiratory tract. And those cilia are those little hair-like things that help you move mucus up and out. So with decreased ciliary action comes an increased risk for pneumonia. And any chronic disease, so diabetics, congestive heart failure, cancer, people on chemotherapy, people that have had organ transplants who are on high-dose steroids, high-dose immunosuppressants, anyone who is on any type of immunosuppressant, like people with autoimmune diseases and they're on immunosuppression, they're at a much higher risk for developing pneumonia. All right, so I now have the three main types to talk about because they are a little different in their causes and then how they present in the patient. So the first type I have listed is called lobar pneumonia. Now, this is what most people think of when they think about pneumonia because it is the most common type. It's also called pneumococcal pneumonia because the bug that is responsible for it is called strep pneumoniae. Now, this is a bacteria. Now, when someone does develop pneumonia, we really hope that it's this type. because a bacteria is most easily treated with antibiotics. This is just the most easy type of pneumonia to treat. It's the least deadly. It's the most common. So this is most of the time what we think of when somebody says, you know, I have pneumonia. We think of lobar pneumonia. Now the signs and symptoms. This is where it's important to understand how each of these types present, because it's all about learning what's unique about certain disease processes instead of trying to memorize every single sign or symptom. You know that people with pneumonia are going to cough, all right? But what's that sputum going to look like? Well, with lobar pneumonia, the sputum will probably have a rusty color. And this is kind of unique to this type of pneumonia. What this bacteria does is it floods the alveoli. It causes a very particular inflammatory response within the alveoli. The alveolar capillaries are damaged. And what happens is white blood cells and red blood cells leak into the airway. And so when the patient coughs up sputum, it's going to be rusty colored. So that's how that bacteria, that particular bacteria, acts on the alveoli. And that's the exact type of inflammatory response that this type of bacteria causes. So there's white blood cell leakage, red blood cell leakage, causing that rusty colored sputum. You're going to hear crackles because of alveolar collapse, because of fluid. Eventually, you're going to hear bronchial breath sounds in places that you are not supposed to be hearing them. So let's say somebody develops a right middle lobe pneumonia. And that is going to eventually cause consolidation of a whole bunch of fluid in that right middle lobe, okay? Because it is consolidated to one lobe. That's why we call it lobar pneumonia. That's another reason why we prefer pneumonia to be lobar, because if it's confined to one lobe, it's also going to be easier to treat. But what happens when all that fluid becomes consolidated and settles into one lobe, that lobe is then going to act as like a magnifier of sounds. So the sounds, when you go to listen to the patient's breath sounds, they're going to be magnified in areas around that right middle lobe. So you're going to hear those deep bronchial breath sounds in places like probably the right upper lobe that you wouldn't normally hear bronchial breath sounds. Normally, you know, out in these areas, you're going to hear bronchovesicular, not bronchial. But in those areas of consolidation, the sound is going to bounce off that fluid and become more bronchial sounding in nature. And on x-ray, you will see consolidation, all right? So on chest x-ray, they will say that consolidation is noted in the, you know, right middle lobe. So that is just kind of a brief overview of lobar pneumonia, the unique signs and symptoms that you're going to see and why you're going to see those signs and symptoms. The next type I have listed is called bronchopneumonia. Now, the most often or the most common cause of bronchopneumonia is aspiration. So are people that come in with strokes or people with decreased level of consciousness for any reason that vomit, you know, or whatever, and they aspirate, then that leaves them wide open to a plethora of bacteria. When you aspirate vomit or you aspirate food or something, then multiple bacteria are going to grow. So that's what makes this type of pneumonia a tad bit more difficult to treat, because multiple bacteria are involved. And because multiple bacteria are involved, it's going to make the sputum a yellow-green color, all right? So that is what kind of makes a bronchopneumonia unique, is that the sputum will not be rusty colored like it is up here. It'll be yellow-green because of the plethora, all the different types of bacteria that have invaded the patient's alveoli. All right, so that is bronchopneumonia. Finally, we have interstitial pneumonia. Now, interstitial pneumonia is the type of pneumonia we don't want anybody to get. It is the most deadly. It has the highest mortality rate. It is the most difficult to treat because interstitial pneumonia is mostly affects our immunocompromised patients, our severely immunocompromised, like HIV and AIDS patients, those folks, like I said, that have had organ transplants, that are on high-dose immunosuppressants and corticosteroids, is caused by an opportunistic fungus. And that opportunistic fungus is pneumocystis carinii. All right, so this PCP, pneumocystis carinii pneumonia, is what just kills a large, vast majority of our AIDS patients. You know, I always explain that AIDS doesn't kill anybody, right? But the infection that the AIDS patient contracts is what kills them because their immune system is so suppressed. And PCP is like the number one killer of our AIDS patients. So it's opportunistic. Funguses, fungi are opportunistic like that. They're like prowling around looking for people with weak immune systems so they can jump in there and cause all kinds of problems. So the unique signs and symptoms to interstitial pneumonia is a non-productive cough. What happens with this nasty fungus is it actually invades those alveoli, and it's going to cause alveolar necrosis, all right? So not only does it enact an inflammatory response and cause fluid leakage and cause the alveoli to fill up with fluid, it actually causes alveolar necrosis. It kills off alveoli. So that is why this is the deadliest form of pneumonia. So you're going to have, or you're going to see, a non-productive cough because it's not so much a fluid issue, but rather than just an irritated respiratory tract. The respiratory tract is trying to cough because it knows something is there that doesn't need to be, but because of the alveolar necrosis and just death, the cough will be non-productive. Also, if you ever have seen a chest x-ray that shows a ground glass appearance, that is how they describe interstitial pneumonia. All right, the pneumonia is just everywhere. It's not consolidated to one lobe or one lung even. It's everywhere, and they call that a ground glass or sometimes even a honeycomb appearance on chest x-ray. All right, so that is just a real quick overview of the three basic types of pneumonia, the patho underlying each type, and the signs and symptoms that you're going to see because of the patho. And I hope this video has helped you. I hope this has helped clear up some confusion about the different types of pneumonia. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button if you like this video. Head over to thedoctornurse.com and subscribe to our mailing list over there. I'm really hoping to get the Pathopedia completed real soon, so you don't want to miss out on any special offers, or you want to be the first one to know when those Pathopedia are complete, because I'm real excited about them. And I just want to thank you so much for watching my video today, and I hope to see and hear from you guys really soon.